The Saudis used 150 fighter planes in the attack. They have a pretty good air force in Saudi Arabia, more than a pretty good air force. In fact, Prince Bandar, who is the Saudi ambassador to the United States, is a fully qualified F-15 and I think even F-16 pilot. Today at 7:30, he was called to the State Department and told that this was likely to happen if they could get the go-ahead from King Fahd of Saudi Arabia, who is, of course, the king, the ruling member of the family there. That came back from King Fahd. It is all right to launch what they're now calling Desert Storm, and the attack was launched tonight. The Saudis have felt very strongly from the outset that there was only one way to deal with Saddam Hussein of Iraq. He is their neighbor to the north. They were extremely worried, and with good cause, that he was going to invade not just Kuwait, but Saudi Arabia as well. That started Desert Shield first. Now Desert Storm has taken effect in an effort to knock him out. The Saudis have profited from this from a oil point of view. They have pumped a lot more oil, and they've made a lot of money, but they're also writing big checks to help underwrite the cost of this whole operation. Prince Bandar has been a man in the middle of it all, working very carefully and closely with Secretary of State Baker and going back. Let's go now to Washington, D.C., to Colonel Harry Summer, who's standing by, and Ed Peck. There are two of our political and military experts who are with us tonight. Gentlemen, the President of the United States did not pull the trigger, in effect, until he got the go-ahead, if you will, from King Fahd of Saudi Arabia. That, I would think, is appropriate, don't you think, Colonel Summers?
Oh, exactly. This war, as we said earlier, is a political act, and one of the main things we need to understand is that this is a coalition action. We sometimes, as Americans, think it's all our show, but it's not. And I think it's very significant, especially to the Arab world, that the Arabians were on board before, Saudis were on board before this began.
And Ed Peck, what about the role of Saudi Arabia now in that part of the world? They have been hand in glove with the United States in this massive military operation. In effect, their culture has been invaded by not just a big military machine, but by many of our values as well. And that has been effectively a closed society for a long time. How do you think Saudi Arabia might change as a result of all of this?
Well, I suppose that the first thing will happen is that when the shooting stops and the forces are drawn sharply down, as I assume they would be, Saudi Arabia will tend to go back to the way it was before. And the disruption becomes perhaps intense, but of relatively short duration. And I wouldn't imagine that it would make, to my own way of thinking, make an enormous difference in the overall scheme of things that large numbers of Americans were there for a relatively short time. Saudi Arabia is evolving like every other country in the world, and it'll continue to do so. But I never had the impression that the sort of events that have led up to this war would make a lasting, deep impression in that very short space of time in which there was this interaction.
You heard the United Nations ambassador from Kuwait, Mohammed Abul Hassan, talking about his country and what we can expect once they return to power, as he hopes, obviously, that they will. What can we expect from Kuwait in terms of a change in its political attitudes, Mr. Peck?
Sir, I have the impression that, you know, that going back to reestablish Kuwait as the way it was is going to be a lot harder than you might imagine. If it's true that the country was almost totally pillaged by the Iraqis, in addition to the killings and all the rest of it, it's going to take it'd be a difficult job to reestablish Kuwait the way it was before. The ruling family has been shaken up quite a bit by the events that transpired. The country has been economically set back quite a ways. Politically, it's going to be altered dramatically. And I would suppose that once the Kuwaiti royal family gets back in position and begins to reestablish itself, that country will emerge markedly different from what it was before the Iraqi invasion of August 2nd.
Colonel Summers, let me ask you to go put on your old hat. You're retired now from the active military, but you did see more than your share of combat in Korea and in Vietnam as well. You're up near the front tonight, back in your old job. You've got a battalion under your command, and you're hearing these reports of an air attack. What's going through your mind at this hour?
Certainly a great deal of anticipation, a great deal of anxiety to some degree that you're ready. Anxiety more to the fact, are you prepared for this? Are you ready? Have you done all the things that you should have done to make sure your men are well-equipped, well-trained, and ready for this? So I think that's really the state of mind that's going on right now.
You've got a whole lot of people, however, in your unit who have never seen combat before. They joined the Army because they thought maybe they could get help with a college education or for a variety of other reasons. They did not expect a shooting war to begin. Based on your ability to assess this army from this distance and the kind of training that they've received, how confident would you be of the ground forces?
I must say, having joined the Army myself for a pre-college education and got caught up in the Korean War, I understand their feelings. But I think this is the best trained army we have ever had on the beginning of a war, that the quality of the force is unbelievably good and their training has been exceptional.
And the high-tech warfare that we can launch on the ground, you have confidence in that as well? Those attack helicopters and the armor units in a very hostile environment, after all.
Well, I must say, as an infantryman, high-tech is a good infantry rifle, but yes, I think the equipment is good, but I think the soldier, the Army is peculiar in that, in the Army at least, the weapons support the soldier rather than the other way around, and I think the weapons are good, but our soldiers are very good, and I think that they'll equip themselves very well.
We're going to show another map, if we can, of that area as you and I talk about this, Colonel Summers. We can point out where those forces are positioned in northern Saudi Arabia and along the Kuwaiti border, but you would not expect, I gather, that there will be a frontal attack right there where we see Kuwait spelled out, correct?
Almost certainly no frontal attack, except attack by fire, but certainly not by troops.
And if it comes to ground forces, describe for us as we look at that map how they would come in left to right.
Well, I think what we'll do is, as I say, attack by fire along the line, and the objective there is to keep the Iraqi forces pinned down so that they can't move and that they can't maneuver against us. I think we will at least feint and maybe carry through with an invasion on the coast by the Marines. Even the threat of that ties down some five Iraqi divisions. And then at the proper time when the enemy forces have been softened up as much as possible by fire, then I think probably to the west we'll see an armor thrust to pierce through their lines and get behind them and cut Kuwait off literally from Iraq itself.
What are our fears tonight about the Iraqi army? They've got a whole lot of tanks and some of them pretty sophisticated Soviet tanks, correct?
Exactly so. Yeah, they have good T-72 is a good tank. It's not as good as the M1 Abrams, but it's a good tank, and they've got a lot of them.
But do we think that they can roll those tanks after this kind of an air attack?
And that's the critical point to understand. Air control is essential. Once we gain air control, and we certainly will gain air control, then their armor forces will be almost impossible for them to move. So that the air campaign and the ground campaign fits together.
That business about an air campaign, describe for us the kind of attack. What come from helicopters? The F-15 is not particularly effective, as I gather, against tanks on the ground. So it would be the new Apache helicopters and the old Cobras.
It'll be the Warthogs, of course, that are specifically designed as tank busters. The Apache helicopters with their Hellfire missile systems, but also as we saw and we talked about a little bit yesterday, the B-52s used in a ground support role can be just devastating. That is, as we said yesterday, that whole divisions at Khantoum, for example, in Khe Sanh, just disappeared, and we can expect that kind of very massive bombing of the front lines at some stage in this air campaign.
All right, thanks very much, Colonel Harry Summers, who's been on the front lines himself, military strategist and instructor at the War College, and a guy who's been following all of this very carefully, describing the kind of training that these men received. When you talk to those people at the field command level in Saudi Arabia, colonels, majors, captains even, they said that they were in fact grateful that they had 5 months in the desert sands to get their troops ready. The troops quickly got eager to go home or to go forward, but the commanders were very happy to have that 5 months to adjust not only to the climate, but to work out their forces and their strategy in the desert sands. And they got used to the idea of sandstorms, colder desert nights at the end, living among camels and now moving up north and waiting to see just how effective this airstrike will be.